good.
Good afternoon, everyone, and a very warm welcome to this ceremony of remembrance and the celebration of the life of Stephen Johnston. Can I also say good morning to all of Stephen's friends who are joining us by live stream from Australia, which is currently 1:45 a.m. I understand that many of Stephen's friends and Diesel will be there. You guys will, of course, know Stevie now as the legend that is Stevie J. My name is Les Gray, and I'm privileged to have been asked by Stephen's family to conduct this ceremony for him here today. Now, I've known Stephen's dad for around 37 years, so I consider it an honour that he's trusted me with delivering this tribute to his dear son, Stephen. As we remember listening to the words of My Heart Will Go On, sang by Celine Dion, and of course part of the soundtrack for Titanic, the movie. And those words are very appropriate for today as we think about Stephen. This service may seem a bit unusual for some of you who are perhaps used to religious ceremonies. This will be a humanist service, especially dedicated to the celebration of the life of the amazing young man, Stevie J. Johnston. We won't be singing hymns nor saying prayers, but we will be paying homage to the life of Stephen. And although I never had the pleasure of knowing Stephen, I did very quickly realise when I sat down with his dad, Davey's partner Alice, Stephen's partner Lisa, and his best mate James, and others, that Stephen was a remarkable young man who has touched the lives of everyone that he met. I immediately knew it was going to be a very difficult task to condense the life of Stephen into a service here and later on at Dundurrie. Stephen was a one-off for sure, and I know it's a well-used cliche, but there's absolutely no doubt that when they made Stephen Johnston, they really did throw away the bolt. Stephen was a man who loved life and loved his partner Lisa, Dad Davey, and everyone that knew him. He was the life and soul of any party and loved a good laugh. So with that in mind, let me read this poem to you. Feel no guilt in laughter, he knows how much you care. Feel no sorrow in a smile that he's not here to share. You cannot grieve forever, he would not want you to. He told that you would carry on the way you always do. So talk about the good times and the ways that you showed you cared, the days you spent together and the happiness that you shared. Let his memory surround you. A word someone may say will certainly recapture a time, an hour, a day. I picked this verse in particular for the first line. Feel no guilt in laughter. He knows how much you care. Stephen had a good sense of humour, which is why we hope that you won't feel guilty for having a wee laugh or a smile on your face today. It's what he would have wanted. Stephen Johnston was born on the 20th of December 1978 at Bells Hill Maternity Hospital, much to the delight of his mum Hazel and Dad Davey. He travelled home in style a day later. When Dad Davey was called by the hospital, he said, "If you get here in the next hour, mum and baby can go home." Davey and Miss Patterson were on duty and in the CID car at the time and took them home in the police motor. So they travelled home in style. You could get away with stuff like that back in the day. Stephen was a typical wee boy. His mum would send him out nice and clean and he'd come back in mock it. Which for the benefit of our Australian friends means not very clean. Stephen attended Greenhills Primary School and again was a typical wee boy. He had lots of friends at this time, and despite his tender years, he made a decision that would be viewed by others as life-changing. You see, Stephen, like all the boys he went to school with and palled around with, was a Glasgow Rangers supporter. Because that's what happened in Coatbridge, and dare I say, in the west of Scotland at that time. Protestants supported Rangers, and Catholics supported Celtic. However, Stephen decided one day to wind his pals up and changed allegiances by letting it be known, from this day on, he's now a Celtic supporter. His dad, Davey, thought it won't last. However, as we'll later learn, Stephen, a.k.a. Stevie J, would grow up to become a die-hard and dedicated Celtic fan. Now, for the benefit of our Australian friends, let me put that into context for you. This was unheard of at that time. It just didn't happen. If you can imagine an Australian rugby fan suddenly waking up one day and announcing that he would support the All Blacks instead of Australia. Or a cricket fan supporting England and not the Aussies when it came to the Ashes. In the west of Scotland, and in particular Coatbridge, football was your religion and vice versa. Common questions when someone started a job or was introduced to a new group would be, what school did you go to? What team do you support? Or what foot do you kick with? All designed to find out, depending who was asking the questions, of course, are you one of them or one of us? Stephen enjoyed his school days and was a happy wee boy, except when his mum nicknamed him Blum. He hated that pet name, especially if he was out playing with his pals and his mum would shout, "Blum, Stevie, come in and get your bath." He would be raging. And Blum wasn't the only dodgy nickname that Stephen picked up. Dad Dave used to take him away with the police angling section and taught him how to fly fish. And on one such trip, Stephen was wading out to cast when he fell down a hole and Joe Grant shouted, "Davey, why are you using poor Stephen as a lipstick?" So in true polar fashion, every trip after that, the guys called Stephen Dipstick. Stephen loved the fly fishing and also took up golf. And much to his dad's dismay, Stephen was beating him after only 2 months. He excelled at the BBs, and his proudest moment was winning the gymnastics award, even though his arm was in a stookie, which is a plaster for those of you from Australia. Stephen was very accident prone and had many broken limbs and gashes from his adventures. He loved animals, so much so that his paper round used to take him twice the time to complete, as he stopped at all the houses with cats and dogs and spent time with them. Later, when he could drive, he stopped his car across Scotland's busiest motorway, the M8 in Glasgow, to help a windy fox. And Stephen left the high school and started working in Monkland's sports shop in Coatbridge, before moving on to a job in an electronics factory in East Kilbride, and then to Chamberlain's, who manufactured electric garage doors. And Stephen, like all young men, had a great wee social life. And we go with his friends, Kirsty and her brother Kenny, or as he called them, Neighbour. That translates to neighbour for our friends in Australia. And now, thanks to you and your wonderful soap opera, they kind of shared with us, neighbours, everybody needs good neighbours. But maybe not the ones that keep you out from Thursdays to Mondays, Kenny, Kirsty and Co. Stephen and the gang would go out on a Thursday night and sometimes not return until the Monday morning. Their favourite Coatbridge haunts were, of course, McFly's, the Colour Cafe, which sounds very continental, but it wasn't, Sandro's Chip Shop, and of course, the Monday Night Gentlemen's Club, which was basically just an excuse to extend the weekend to include a Monday night's drinking. He was always up for a laugh and loved being the life and soul of the party. He had a famous clumsy date one night where he leaned back in the seat in a very fancy restaurant, lost his balance, grabbed the tablecloth and pulled the whole lot over himself. And then there was a day when he took a young lady to see The Passion of Christ and, not being a Bible student, asked the young lady in all seriousness if the disciples were Jesus' pals. Stephen's pals, although I'm not sure about disciples, Kirsty, Kenny, Alan, Doogie, Lee, Paula, Chris and Colin, to name but a few, all agree that they knew Stephen when he was at his best. And they were at their best, all young and full of mischief. Stephen had a very bad habit of running the works vans into the ground and blew at least 4 inches that we know of, meaning, of course, he couldn't get to work. He loved his cars and was always washing his car in the driveway. And he had an amazing way with children. They just took to him. Alice's grandson, Corbin, who doesn't take to strangers, felt very comfortable in Stephen's company, as did Harry and Eve. All three loved him and found him very easygoing, unlike Davy, who was allegedly nicknamed Grumpy Grandpa. I don't know why, Davy. Sadly, Stephen's mum Hazel passed away in 2002, and of course, he and his dad were devastated. Stephen had friends in Australia, and in 2004, started to look at going there on a year's visa to see if he would like it. Stephen spoke with his dad, and in March 2005, he left Coatbridge with all of his worldly possessions and a small hold all and set off for Oz. Stephen settled in the Mornington Peninsula in Victoria, made famous, of course, by the song Mornington Ride, sung by the Seekers, released in 1966. Stephen was looked after by his friend Tom from Coatbridge, who set him up a job with South East Water Utilities Land Engineering, a job which he still held when he returned to Scotland last month. His boss Roscoe was a Scotsman from Kilmarnock, and he very kindly warned Stephen about the Australian drop bears that would drop on your head from the bushes if you weren't careful, referring, of course, to koala bears. Stephen later admitted that he fell for a hook, line and sinker for 3 weeks until Roscoe couldn't keep his laugh in any longer. Stephen was contracted to work in New Zealand and we've got 2 weeks on and 1 week off, and just loved it. He moved to Frankston, which is an outer suburb of Melbourne in Victoria. New Frankston, with its population of approximately 35,000, is also known to be a bit wild at times, and is nicknamed Frank Ganistan by the locals. That didn't bother Stephen one wee bit. He used to say, it's just like Coatbridge, but with sunshine. Stephen palled around with numerous expat Scots and continued with his usual hectic social life. And as I said earlier, he loves his cars. And it was here that he bought his pride and joy, a 2003 Holden Monaro muscle car with its 5.7 litre V8 engine. And of course, it was green, the same as his beloved Celtic. What else? Dad, Davey and Alison were over for a visit in 2007, and Davey took it for a spin. And whilst doing around 130 miles an hour, Davey said, that'll do for me. And Stephen replied, it can go much faster than that, Dad. But Davey wasn't tempted. Davey and Ali loved their visit with Stephen and brought back some amazing memories which they will cherish. Stephen bought a 10-seater and a racehorse, and I'm not sure if it ever won anything for him. And on the 7th of November 2007, he got his beloved Staffordshire English Terrier dog, Diesel, or Dees for short. Stephen would often say that Diesel was his son, his soulmate, and would dote on him. Diesel has a great nature and loved people and other dogs, and Stephen would get pulled up from time to time by the local police for not having a muzzle on him, or if he was off the leash. In 2008, Stevie won a darts competition, darts doubles, and in 2010, was introduced to a young lady called Lisa Garvey, who would end up playing pool in Stevie's team at the Dandenong Workers' Club. Lisa herself played in the Australian national team, but Stevie and the guys would wind her up by saying, it's just check pool. It's fair to say that Stephen and Lisa didn't hit it off right away. Lisa thought he was a loud upstart, which was probably a very apt description. However, over the next 6 months, they played in the same pool team, and then they started dating. And after that, they started to play pool in competitions around Victoria and Australia. They had an amazing relationship, and whilst they loved being together, they also had their own space, which was essential for the both of them. They were both firm favourites on the pool scene in Australia and part of the furniture at Walker's Pool Hall in Dandenong. It was their second home, so much so that after the news of Stephen's accident reached them, the pool family got together at Walker's, and we'll see a photograph at the front here. They did a fundraiser for Stevie and they raised an incredible amount of $17,500. Their pool team was called the Imports, and Stevie J was always the captain. They played on Monday nights and Thursday nights, and in the first season, they won the league and picked up around $5,000 in prize money. However, not everyone was happy about Stevie J getting away to play pool. Diesel would go to Huff for about 2 weeks whenever Stevie got back home and would ignore him. The guys would say, whenever they first met Diesel, oh my god, he looks just like Stevie. And when Stevie was preparing his trip home to Scotland, he was winding Diesel up saying, I'm going home and you're staying here. Stevie was the main man when it came to organising things. He was a go-to person and was in charge of picking outrageous shirts for everyone to wear during the pool comps. The pool family are getting special shirts made with Stevie J number 7 on them and Freedom, which was one of Stevie's nicknames. So called after the Braveheart movie, of course, starring that well-known Scottish actor, Mel Gibson. Stevie made all the travel and accommodation arrangements and just loved being the captain and organiser, especially when it came to playing in the Ashes, which is basically the UK versus Oz. And on the Library Forum, the latest score is 2-2. Stevie was proud of his Scottish heritage and loved wearing his kilt. Nobody ever doubted he was a true Scotsman, as he would often prove it just for the sake of it. And of course, he used to play the bagpipes. Stevie and his best mate James met around 2013 and became inseparable. They played pool together and got up to all sorts. And like all young guys, they loved taking the mickey out of one another, especially when it came to nicknames. Stevie called James Upside Downhead, and many more names which I can't repeat here today. There was one name in particular though, that James kept up his sleeve until Stevie was really annoying him. He'd simply say that Stevie was English. advantage. Stevie was also a very generous man and organised fundraisers for families who'd lost a loved one or were just experiencing hard times. That was when he was at his best, helping others. He was always the last man standing in night's suit, and you could generally hear him before you saw him. People would ask, "Is Stevie G here tonight?" It's awful quiet. Everyone knew Stevie was Celtic daft, and he managed to get quite a few of his local mates to start watching and supporting Celtic on Fox TV Sports, and was seldom seen without a Celtic top on and usually with the number 7 on it. In early December 2016, Stephen learned that his dear grandmother, Granny Mary MacDonald, was very ill in Perth around February and planned a surprise trip back home. He arrived at his dad's house on the 14th of December, and when David got home, he found Stevie standing in the kitchen. David was completely caught off guard and said, "Good day, old chap." One wasn't expecting one back home. Why didn't one call me? My words very similar to that. It was an amazing surprise and a most welcome one for Davy and Ali. Stephen visited his dear gran every day. Stephen enjoyed catching up with his old friends and neighbours and had a beer or two in Coatbridge. Some of his pals slagged him off for his lack of a Scottish accent. He saw the Scottish Snooker Championships at the Emirates with his pal Carol Crawford, and of course managed to see his favourite team, Celtic, beating the Dundee at Parkhead on the 17th of December 2016. Stevie celebrated his birthday on the 20th of December and had a great time catching up, seeing his family and friends. And you're aware that there are hundreds of posts about Stevie G on social media, and I'd be here all day if I could quote them all. So here is just a very small sample of them. Troy said, "Sitting here at your second home and not seeing you smile or hearing your accent is something that will take a long, long time to get used to. You are truly an amazing human being who made everyone's lives so much better just for having you in it. If there was an award given for making a difference to people's lives, you would surely be at the top of that list. I, along with many others, will never forget all the good times we shared together and all the good times you were there to pick us up if we were having a bad day." Troy would want to say about Lisa, "It was easy to see why Stevie chose you as his life partner. You are an amazingly strong woman who also possesses a heart of gold." Lisa got a new tattoo after Stevie passed, which reads, "Stevie G, not gone away, just gone ahead. Love you till the end of time. You'll never walk alone." The words speak for themselves. Someone else who was very special to Stevie wrote a poem. "Stevie G, you are a friend to everyone in need. You loved your pool, you loved your beer, and most of all, Parkhead. You loved your soulmate Lisa, who balanced out your life. She soothed your soul, bathed your wounds, and helped you with all the strength. You've left us now, and you'll be missed, especially for your smile, and how you made us feel good, just for a little while. Rest in peace. We'll think of you each time we watch the game. Life will go on, and we will too, but it'll never be the same. You're with your mum, safe in her arms, not quite a babe again, but cared for, loved, and at peace, and never more in pain." All we wrote about Stevie G, "I'll never forget your smile, Stevie G, or your laugh, or the need for subtitles whenever you got excited." And we're now going to hear a reading from Stevie's friend, James.
Hi everyone, my name's James. I'm Stevie's best mate back from Australia. David, Ellie and Lisa have given me the privilege to be able to share some stories from some of his close mates back home. Here are some stories from some of his mates which they would like to share with everyone so you can all see what type of person he was back there. From Doc, "I remember every time going to watch Celtic at Stevie's, and he would go to the toilet during the game and Celtic would score. I would go nuts, he would stop peeing, run and jump up and down, hug me, swear, but he couldn't wait to go back and finish peeing." From Jammo, "Stevie invited me to his house one night and plastered the spare room where I was staying for the night. with Celtic paraphernalia. I'm a massive Rangers fan. Mitchy C, Big John loves you, and they'll get Taylor Adams and Brian Swift to sing a song in his name. From Wee Man, you are gone too early, Stevie. My heart goes out to you. I'll always remember you when I drink one of those horrible pure blondes or when I watch one of those Celtic games. I'll miss your antics, but most of all, I'll miss a true friend and a brother, and please watch over Lisa. His Australian dad, JR, who is going to organise all the Hawaiian shirts for our Wontucky defence, who will post the pictures every time one of us has to jug it up, which is when only one person out of the team wins one game, or loses, sorry. Who is going to cause us to miss the flight back home after Barry? Who is going to put the squashed up cream cakes for Kerry to find in my bag when unpacking after weekends away? So many memories, Bairnsdale, Barry, Bendigo, Albury, Sale, Wonthaggi, they'll never be the same. So may win more often now, but will never be as much fun. Thursday nights at Potters won't be the same either. You have left a huge hole in the eight ball fraternity in Melbourne and have made it so much more memorable for everyone. By the way, Stevie, I'm finally prepared to admit that it was not you, it was you, not me, that potted the winning black in the Gippy Cup. You've never learnt to pronounce my name either. It was Boof, not Boof. Chipper. I've never met a person with such a different playing style. He would tilt, twist, lean, kick, steer his shots to such extremities that we would stand back and just watch him and not the game. Sometimes it would get so bad that I thought he was going to fall over. I put out my arms to catch him, and what did I get? Stevie telling me off for trying to feel him up. I'm sure wherever you are, you're making everyone laugh with your antics and that funny way you talk. You will live on in our memories and our hearts, mate. I am so very honoured that you called me a mate. Cheers to you, big guy, Chipper. From Papa Smurf, who was another guy who we met down the Mornington Peninsula. I feel so privileged to have known you, Stevie. You made a big impact in my life. You always made me laugh, even when I was down. I'll never forget the Barry trip with you, especially the night we spent 2 hours looking for you. Then someone came in and said, we found him, he was asleep in the dunny, which is the toilet. Good trick to you to get out of your shout, Stevie. You're the best mate I've ever had, Stevie boy. I love you to bits. I'm going to miss you so much. Rest in peace, mate. And from myself, Stevie, words can't explain how I'm feeling at the moment and will be for a long time to come. You have been such a good mate to me. You have been more like a brother than a mate. From the times where I needed someone to talk to, and same for you two with me. Along with the many pool comps we went to, there are many memories I'll always be thinking of which we shared. But this is the one which will always make me laugh. It was the night of my 30th birthday where we had plenty to drink and we decided to have a few helium balloons just to call each other names like we normally do. And I couldn't stop laughing. There are so many people back at home who will miss you and love you. All I've been wanting to do is just call your phone and have a chat with you like we did every day. And now I have no idea who I'm going to call just to have a chat about our random crap. Lisa and I hopefully were able to tick off a couple of things from your bucket list. One of them is being invited by the Celtic Football Club to have had a tour around the grounds to meet a couple of players, and they have so kindly donated a club shirt with all the players on it. But I know Lisa and I, and many, many others, would give up everything we have to have you back in our lives. And to hear that funny accent of yours and to hear you say 11 and speak like an Aussie again. It's going to be so sad when I can't call you, and every time we answer the phone, a lot of you might not like it, but we always answered it by saying, nah, fanny balls. Now, Stevie, all you have to do is fire up and bleep off. Love you, mate, and forever always. Just remember, Stevie, this isn't goodbye, it's catch you later, and you'll never walk alone.
Thank you, James, that was really special. Stephen had been at night out on the 23rd of December 2016, and returned home early, in the early hours of Christmas Eve. It was a very stormy night, and Stephen was blown over in the strong wind and sustained a serious head injury. He was taken to Monkland's Hospital and then transferred to the Queen Elizabeth Hospital. His family and friends visited him and Lisa flew in from Australia on New Year's Eve after getting an emergency passport approved so she could be beside his bedside. Stephen sadly passed away peacefully in the early hours of the 24th of January 2017 at the Queen Elizabeth Hospital. And I know he'll be greatly missed by everyone who had the pleasure of knowing him. His friend James flew out to be with Lisa, David and Ali when they heard the tragic news. And we're now going to have a period of reflection for you to remember Stephen or Stevie J in your own personal way. And while we do that, we will listen to a special piece of music which was a particular favourite of Stephen's. So please, while listening, let your thoughts drift to your memories of Stephen and remember him when he was at his best. It's I'll Be Missing You by Puff Daddy and Faith Evans.
Thank you.
Shortly moving on to Dalgowie Crematorium to say a final farewell to Stephen. And Stephen's family have asked me to extend an invitation to you all to join them there. We will reflect and think about Stephen before we say our final farewell. I hope that as we close this part of the tribute for Stephen, you'll be able to focus on something about him that made you smile. And you'll be able to remember him not only with a heavy heart, but also with a sense of calm. You reflect that he's at peace. But before we conclude our ceremony here, Stephen's family have asked me to express their heartfelt thanks to each and every one of you for your attendance here today, for the cards, the flowers, support and condolences, which have been such a comfort to them. In particular, I would like to personally thank, on my behalf and behalf of Stephen's dad and family and friends, Michael McDonald, Peter Lawwell and Celtic FC, for their amazing support and generosity shown towards Stevie's dad, David, Stevie's partner, Lisa, and his best friend, James, when they attended the Celtic v Hearts match on the 28th of January and got the full Celtic family treatment. It's been such a tonic for everyone, so thank you guys, and thank you, Tom, for coming along here today to show your support for one of your lifetime supporters. It has really boosted everyone's morale and shown us what the Celtic family is all about. I'd also like to give a special mention to some of Stevie J's Australian family before we say goodbye to them. Sean and Jane Partridge, Dan Willis, Barry, Tony and Carol Wakefield, and Eleanor, all from Potters Hall. Milo, Michelle, Doc, Jenny, David, Alice, JR, Tracy, Colby, and the dozens and dozens of you out there who counted Stevie J as your friend. And to the countless others who have said in social media, they didn't know Stevie J that well, but wish they had. Thank you all very much indeed. Also, you're all invited to join Stephen's family at the Tudor Hotel in Airdrie following our farewell at the crematorium, where light refreshments will be provided and further memories of the Stephen you knew may be shared. That invite doesn't include your viewers from Australia, of course. I'm sure you guys will be having many tribute nights for the legend that was and still is Stevie J. There will be a collection on the way out for the neurosciences at the Queen Elizabeth Hospital. Thank you all once again for being here today.
Thank you.